Good afternoon. Welcome back to Grand Rounds. Please remember to sign the attendance record at the back of the auditorium, and then also please, if you could, fill out the evaluations of the program and give us any ideas that you might have in regards to future topics or future speakers. Today, I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Richard Cano. Dr. Cano attended medical school at Stanford and then stayed there to do his postgraduate training in anesthesiologist. He is a member of the Department of Anesthesiology at MGMC and at McFarland since 2010, and he is kindly joining us today to update us on preoperative evaluations from the anesthesia perspective. And please join me in welcoming Dr. Cano.
Thank you. Can everybody hear me okay? Sounds good. I feel a little bit like a rock star here. For those of you who haven't met me or been around me, I'll just let you know I'm kind of an energetic guy. I tend to talk somewhat with a pressured speech. So if I fly through this, sorry about that. But I think there's a lot of information to cover. And hopefully there'll be time at the end for some questions. So today I'm going to talk to you about preoperative evaluation, which to my specialty is an incredibly important stage of preparing a patient for not only surgery, but getting them through it from a safe standpoint and from meeting their patient's expectations. And so how it came about that I'm up here even talking to you about this is in the end of last year, Mary Greeley Medical Center hired a consultant group to come in and basically look at our OR utilization and how efficient we are at doing that. And out of this assessment of what we were doing, one, it came out that we weren't using the OR nearly as efficient as we could. And so we went through a series of basically cultural and procedural changes to try and implement strategies which might help us increase our efficiency in the OR. Of this was born the Surgical Services Executive Committee, which some of you may have heard, which is, you know, we affectionately call it the SSEC. I and a group of other anesthesiologists, orthopedic surgeons, general surgeons, podiatrists, and such, we get together on an every month basis now and sort of decide how we go forward in implementing changes to increase our OR utilization. And we stem this by looking at surgical block time and how we assign that, how we change that, how do we look at turnover time, how do we release block time. But in red is where I'm concentrating on today, which is how do we reduce cancellations and or delays on the day of surgery. So the goals of this discussion are to improve the preoperative evaluation of our patients by providing a systems-based understanding of our anesthetic concerns. If you go to a university hospital like University of Iowa, Stanford, Mayo, a lot of those places have the ability to have a preoperative evaluation clinic that is basically run by anesthesiologists and nurse practitioners to handle the volume of all the patients that need surgery. They just go down to another floor or to a different department and they get evaluated by people who are in the know of what anesthesia is looking for surgery. Well, we don't have that here. Here we're, you know, a smaller community, smaller based hospital, and we utilize our primary care providers, whether they be nurse practitioners, family practice, internal medicine doctors, or the likes. So we get them from all over, these preoperative evaluations, and as you can imagine, we get a wide variety of some that are good and some that are completely useless. So what I want to do here is sort of give a background an inside perspective to your outside perspective, and to hopefully create a dialogue between us, not only the evaluators, which I hope that there's more coming on to hear this, but our nursing staff, the main OR, and of course with our anesthesia department. There's a lot of jokes about anesthesia, that we never talk to our patients are always asleep. Well, the truth is we're not some Neanderthals just sitting there waiting for the next one to come in so we could drop a rock on their head and make them go to sleep and then wash our hands of them and then they're gone. Obviously not the case, and this is a cartoon my aunt sent me, which is near and dear to my heart because it kind of looks like me holding the rock. So what's the role of the anesthesiologist? Well, it's my job and my colleague's job to provide a thorough pre-anesthetic evaluation of each patient, and delve into treatments prior to surgical procedures which can optimize their safety, their pain, and their nausea standpoint. I also have to medically manage patients during their anesthetic procedures. Now, this sounds like, oh, well, you get them in there, you put them off to sleep, and everything's fine. Well, for those of you who aren't in the OR or may not remember what the OR was like, the OR is a very dynamic situation. You take patients with a myriad of comorbidities from the heart, lungs, brain, the likes, and you put them under surgery, which is a high inflammatory state, a high thrombotic state. You have blood loss, you have fluid shifts, you have respiratory mechanics that change, you put them in different positions. So at the end of it, it's very, 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 very dynamic. And so for me to devise a plan that can help me optimize them, optimally take care of them during that case, I have to have a really good understanding of their physiology. And so this is where the preoperative evaluation comes in. Then I also have to come up with a post-anesthesia plan. Are we going to put them in the ICU? Are they going to go to telemetry? Are they going to go home? Are they going to go to the floor? So on and so on. By doing this system, I'll delve into the history of the safety of anesthesia, which back in 1985, the Anesthesia Patient Foundation was created, which was prompted to raise a level of awareness of safety issues with regards to patients undergoing surgery. In 1986, the American Society of Anesthesiology was the first specialty to adopt standards of care for how we go about doing this, and currently, we have more than 30 standards of care that you can find on our website that we all pretty much have to abide by. And I'll tell you what, I definitely live by them because they work. And so from 50 years ago, when you have perioperative deaths that were about 1 in 1,500 that were due to anesthesia circumstances, we're now down to about 1 in 200,000. So a dramatic, dramatic change. So as I said before, preoperative evaluation is very, very, very important. I'm going to show you a little cartoon here, which I doctored up. So patient, medical history, heart, blah, 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 cleared for surgery. Sometimes we get some of these, which is like, what do you mean, blah, 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 blah? That's not gonna work. So what is the role of it? Well, if I have a comprehensive understanding of the current and past medical conditions, I understand what types of surgeries they may have had and how those surgeries affected them, what complications they may have had, and have a full review of their medications, both prescription and herbal, I can really come up with a safe, logical plan to execute to get them through it safely and comfortably. So I'm here sort of in a begging sense, in that I would love to change the culture about how we go about doing this, in that as a preoperative evaluator, you are really the first line in setting a patient up for a safe and comfortable experience. And so if you approach that rather than a nuisance being in your clinic or somebody you just kind of rush through and just document a few things and yeah, cleared for surgery, if you approach it as you're an extension of the surgical care team. You are the start of it. You are the ones that are starting to create this process for us to get them through them, through the procedure. It's also an excellent opportunity for somebody who may not have come in otherwise, if their shoulder hadn't hurt and they needed shoulder scope, for you to delve into some of their cardiac issues, pulmonary issues, renal issues, and so on and so forth. So if you can look at it from that standpoint, that you are basically introducing me to a patient that you know better than I do. I'm going to meet them for about 10 minutes before their surgical procedure, and I'm going to have had thought about that, because if you haven't told me about their cardiac condition or their pulmonary condition, then I have to ask. And if I don't like what I hear, I may have to delay that. And that really sets the patient up for a poor, where we're not delivering on our promise that we're going to have surgery that day. So again, I emphasize how important your role is to us. I also want to discuss what is not your role as a preoperative evaluator. Trying to talk out of school is what I call it. If you try to tell the patient what I'm going to do or one of my colleagues is going to do, you're actually maybe setting them up for disappointment. You know, you may tell them something that may be actually false by the way that I or Dr. Cruz or Dr. Drabon actually goes about our business. I liken it to the fact that sometimes a patient will ask me, well, how are you going to manage my diabetes after I have my my colon resection. And I'll explain to them how I'm going to manage it in the perioperative period, but then I'm going to gladly give them back to Dr. Carreno and let Dr. Carreno devise a plan that's going to manage their blood sugars. Same goes for hematology. Same goes for surgery. I don't even tell a patient what kind of pain meds Dr. Taylor is going to give somebody because I don't know and I may be wrong. So if you can avoid discussing what we're going to do, just say, you know what? The anesthesiologist will discuss it with you on the day of, and they will come up with the appropriate plan that you need, and they'll discuss it completely. Also, I really want to get away from the culture of you preoperative evaluators are not clearing a patient for surgery. And why I say this is because it's hard to manage the disappointment when a patient comes in that we are either delaying or canceling, that they always say, but Dr. Hallberg cleared me. Well, Dr. Hallberg isn't here. Dr. Hallberg isn't the one who's doing the anesthesia, and Dr. Hallberg isn't the one doing the surgery. So you're actually not cleared for surgery because what I've assessed is you're not safe to go forward, and that's a huge disappointment for them. So I think if you just use terms like patient is preoperatively evaluated from a cardiac standpoint, so on and so forth, they seem appropriate for the surgical procedure. You can also avoid documenting things like ASA status and airway exams because quite often they're wrong. And so it's in the chart and it's wrong, and then I've got to, you know, it actually doesn't serve any purpose for helping me take care of the patient when they get there. Same goes for regional anesthesia, intubation processes, and monitoring strategies. Just kind of leave that up to us if you could. I'm going to give you an example of a pre-op that I just got a couple weeks ago. So patient's going to have a knee scope. Got an allergy to peanuts, penicillin, erythromycin. I have no idea what kind of allergy. Well, they're taking enalapril, so they must have hypertension. They have hyperlipidemia. So I'm kind of talking out loud what I'm reading as I'm getting ready to go see the patient. They've had surgeries. I don't know how it went. Got hypertension. I don't know how bad or how chronic. I don't know if that blood pressure is what they normally have, or is that just during that office visit? Do they have any upper respiratory issues, you know, infections, asthma? And you kind of read along, the thyroid's good. They're, you know, they got a little bit of a longer head than wide, so that's important. They've got cotton wool patches in their, or they don't have cotton wool patches, so what, their diastolic hasn't been above 90 for a while. And then you get to the heart having a regular rate and rhythm with no arrhythmias, sternal heaves, or bruises. Oh, and then there's a murmur with no trajectory or to the carotids. What? Tell me more. What do you mean they have a murmur? Is it new? Is it benign? Is it innocent? Has it ever been evaluated by echocardiography? 66 years old with chronic hypertension, that could be something that's bad. So it's not just okay to just document something and not give us some idea about what's going on. Because if you don't tell me, then I have to ask. And then I have to go through the motions of figuring out what to do. But it was real important that we had an INR of 0.9. That was really an important piece. I'm hoping that this person, I know this person isn't in the room who wrote this, but this was a very non-informational pre-op. And so what I want to do is go through it. Like what do we need? Because it's rarely adequate for us to just write hypertension, coronary artery disease, COPD, et cetera, and see it in the problem list, but with no explanation. Because that doesn't really define it. It defines that they have it, but it doesn't tell me what kind do they have. How bad is it? How benign is it? So if you can tell us about the severity of the disease or what makes it worse, what makes it better, how stable is it? Are there treatment plans going forward? What treatment plans have worked already? So this will be sort of the theme as I go through each one of these sections. So the first thing I ask every patient is, have you had surgery before? And if you haven't, has anybody in your family had any trouble with it? Because I'm looking for malignant hyperthermia. I'm looking for pseudocholinesterase deficiency. Very, very, very important to know about and very, very, very important to deal with. And we can do it safely without any complications. We've taken care of since I've been here, I think I've personally taken care of about 12 patients with malignant hyperthermia, and we've had no issues. We've had no crises whatsoever. And some of them have just been footnotes in a preoperative evaluation. And so what I want to say with MH is, First of all, if you come across a patient with MH or even the hint of MH, give the OR front desk a call. First thing we're going to do is we're going to make them the first case of the day because we have to prepare the OR for that patient. We have to prepare the staff for that patient. I have to devise an anesthesia plan that involves IV medications for that patient. And this is for all ages. We have to know about it and know about it sooner than later. All right? And then the other thing I would like everybody to do is that if we're willing to put things like zinc or copper in the allergy profile, or thankfully it's starting to phase out putting seasonal allergies in the allergy profile, well then why don't we put succinylcholine and desflurane and isoflurane and sevoflurane in the allergy profile for a patient who has MH? That will definitely raise red flags on the front, on the top banner, that this patient is in trouble. And I think that if we can start doing that on a regular basis, make that a policy, then we don't have to worry about if it's just a footnote in somebody's H&P from some pre-op evaluation. Now I was going to start going through systems base as if we were doing a sort of an ICU sign out. So we'll start at the top. Dr. Kitch will like this. Central nervous system. So psychiatric ailments are obviously common. Me to know what the degree of that psychiatric compromise is actually very, very helpful. What kind of patient do I expect to see when I walk into ACS room 23? Are they going to be extremely nervous? Do I need to have an anxiolytic program in place or thinking about it to make this patient's anxiety, you know, dissipated? Also, if they're on chronic anxiolytics, this can definitely change how they wake up. When you wake up from anesthesia, you're very disinhibited. You go to primitive sort of reflexes and responses, and so if you are on a baseline basis having a difficult time with the world and you're on chronic anxiolytics, I may change all that and may need to have some sort of preparation in my mind for how we're going to manage them in the early recovery period. So it's very helpful to know what's going on. Do they have a history of strokes? I see this all the time. TIA, with nothing else mentioned. Well, what does that mean? Because in the OR, like I said, it's a very dynamic state. Was it a thromboembolic event that's now gone because we've optimized them on Coumadin? And because we're in the OR and it's hypercoagulable, so do I need to look out for clots? Do I need to worry about that in the recovery period if they're not waking up as usual or if they're having a seizure? Do I need to be thinking about that? If they have bad arterial atherosclerotic disease in the brain, I need to think about their perfusionary pressures while they're in the OR, and what sort of limits am I going to let them go up and down based on blood loss, fluid shifts, and the depth of anesthesia. Having an idea of this will definitely help me get them through that without another stroke, hopefully, or to act on it quickly and have a mechanism in place to be prepared for that. Spinal cord injuries, this is a little more esoteric, but it's real important to know what level it is and when did it occur, because autonomic dysreflexia is a very real life-threatening crisis that can happen in the OR in patients who are quadriplegic. Also, respiratory mechanics can change dramatically, and if you have any idea about how they've responded to narcotics or anxiolytics in the past, it's also very helpful to us. Migraines. See this all the time. If a patient who has a migraine every week, as opposed to a patient who has a migraine once every 2 years, very different in how they may be set up for a migraine in the perioperative period. Because anesthesia, especially with the use of Zofran and some narcotics, can actually bring it on. So I need to warn the patient that this is a possibility. And also, if you tell me what treatments have worked in the past, I can employ those right away in the recovery room or have a conversation with the surgeon to have something available for them before they go home or while they're on the floor. Because if it's worked before, it's likely going to work again. Now going into pulmonary, COPD. It's not okay just to say COPD. It's not very helpful. What type is it? Is it emphysema? Is it chronic bronchitis? How much sputum production is occurring? Are they on MDIs? And if they are on MDIs, are they effective? Do they use oxygen? All of this tells me where they are on the spectrum of their pulmonary compromise so that I can manage them in the OR and in the early extubated phase and in the recovery room. In fact, my ventilation strategies are very different from somebody with chronic bronchitis or with emphysema, depending on what position they are in, depending on how much blood loss they've had, depending on if I'm going to put them in the ICU or not. I have to know about this in order to come up with the proper plan. Asthma, another disease on a huge spectrum. If it's exercise-induced and an MDI, I use one or two puffs versus the brittle asthmatic, who the minute I put an endotracheal tube in, they're going to go into an acute bronchospastic event. These are very different patients, and so having an idea of it will help me. And will also dictate on what I might do in the extubation process. How acutely do I need to watch that patient, and how much pain medications do I need to have on board? Other conditions like was the child born term or preemie? Was there RSV an issue? Was the child ventilated? That's going to give me an idea of maybe how reactive they are going to be in the OR. Diaphragmatic hernia, is there congenital pulmonary dysfunction? This is actually really important in that we get kids all the time and you preoperatively evaluate them for otitis media and they need to have their ear tubes. Well, for those of you that deal with them, where do we get them? And sometimes we have maybe a 1 or 2 day window when we can get them into the OR when they're not sick and they're not on antibiotics. So in general, we like to wait 2 to 3 weeks, but we know for a fact that there's some kids we just have to bite the bullet on. Let's say we're going to put ear tubes in. We're actually not going to instrument their airway, so we may not cause an asthmatic situation. Actually, one of the worst kids I took care of here came in for an lap appendectomy, who had a raging middle ear infection with a fever of 102, who also had asthma. And that kid, I mean, he gave me fits. I had to give him epinephrine in the OR to keep him from getting too hypoxic, which in kids, if they get hypoxic, then they start to brady and they can go asystolic. Definitely lost a few years of my life on that kid because I needed to take him to surgery. He had a raging upper respiratory infection, and sure enough, it set off his asthma. By the way, it's also rare to need pulmonary function tests. Dr. Taylor needs them when he does his lobe resections, deciding how much parenchymal tissue to take out. But for an anesthesiologist, it's rarely going to be helpful for me to know really what their FEV1 status is, what their vital capacity is, and such. I'll basically get all the information I need from a good history and physical and functional status. Obstructive sleep apnea. Obviously, it's an underdiagnosed entity. But if it is diagnosed, when was it made, and how compliant are they with their CPAP? That gives me an idea of how much CO2 retention they're used to. Cor pulmonale, how much pulmonary hypertension do they have? Knowing that they're compliant with their CPAP, and they have been for 10 years, is a very different patient than one who's morbidly obese, who I look at them, and I'm diagnosing them with sleep apnea without ever doing a sleep study. So they're obviously very different patients, and you telling me about it is very helpful. This is the meat and potatoes of this talk right here, the cardiovascular. This is the one that obviously warrants the most time, and it's extremely helpful for you to quantify and qualify the status of their disease. So there are several aspects of the cardiac evaluation which may be nebulous to you and may be somewhat, you're sitting there with the patient, you're kind of coming to a fork in the road. Do I get an echo? Do I not get an echo? Do I get a cardiology sort of consultation? At the very end of it, and I'm going to say it in another slide, call us. I'm more than happy to just call the OR front desk. Gina will get in contact with me or one of my colleagues, and I will gladly answer that question so that we can avoid a cancellation or delay on the day of surgery. This rubric I'm going to show you here is born out of the ACC-AHA 2007 guidelines, which was a dramatic pullback from how it used to be done prior to the year 2007, where people used to be sent to get cabbages before their gallbladder could be taken out, or they used to get angiographies, or they used to get echoes for anybody that had any chance of having cardiac disease. Well, what thankfully some really smart people found was that was overkill, and getting revascularized by a cabbage actually didn't help anything, and sometimes it actually made it worse, and the same goes for stenting. And in 2009, this was reviewed and not changed. But basically, it's a setup for success in that it's able to help us identify which patients have heart disease and who are high risk for perioperative cardiac mortality and morbidity, and which of those have modifiable conditions that we can change prior to the surgery. So I'm just going to kind of go through this. So step one is an emergency surgery. Well, if it is, there's not much we can do. I'm not going to go get an echo or get a cath or do much else. We got to take care of it right away. So that's kind of a no-brainer. The second one is, do they have active cardiac conditions? So are they having an MI? Did they just recently have an MI? Do they have decompensated heart failure, which increases your mortality in a perioperative period from about 20 to 30%? That's pretty significant. Do they have a new heart block, SVT or AFib with RVR? This is actually, really important to identify, in that these patients we should probably pull back quite a bit and really only consider life-saving surgery. Now, I say that because I say that, but now here's the caveat. An 85-year-old woman who just broke her hip, who's got severe aortic stenosis, well, I'm not going to have her go get her valve fixed before she needs her hip. She's not going to make it that long. She's going to get, blood clot or pulmonary edema, and, the mortality from hip fracture alone is already bad by itself. So in those situations, if they do have an acute cardiac condition, well, then myself and the cardiologists are going to have to come up with a good plan about how we're going to go about this. And we're also going to have a nice conversation with the surgeons about how much time do we have and how much blood loss can we tolerate. So just because they have those and they don't need a life-saving surgery, we can still possibly do their case. Going down the list, you go into now what are the surgical risks. So there's anesthesia risks and there's surgical risks. Surgeries that carry about a less than 1% chance of cardiac mortality are things like endoscopy, or when Dr. Friedrich is doing a beer block for a carpal tunnel release, or we're doing cataracts. I had this great attending in residency who had this thick Indian accent, and he used to say, if you can have a haircut, you can have a cataract. And I think he's right. Ambulatory surgery is a little, so there's different kinds of ambulatory surgeries. Obviously, we're sending more people home after surgeries that we probably would have kept them before. So that gets a little nebulous. But, knee scopes, Dr. Pogue does some, superficial lesions, things like that. We're probably okay to go to surgery, even if they aren't that great from a cardiopulmonary standpoint. You go to the next one, so we're not having those kind of surgeries. Now we're having all other surgeries. Well, the first thing that we need to look at is functional capacity. And I find that this gets left out of a lot of preoperative evaluation. And if you hopefully start to employ it, please talk about it in terms of METs. So metabolic equivalent of tasks, which is, before I go back to that, back to step two, need to define the terms of MI. So historically, an MI was considered high risk if it happened within the last 3 to 6 months. That's no longer the case. The studies just don't support that they are still high risk. So they've pared it back. An acute MI is one that's happened within the last 7 days, and that's high risk no matter what surgery you're having and no matter what's going on. But if it's happened between 8 and 30 days, if the cardiologist can tell you that there's myocardium at risk, then it's still considered a high-risk component. If there's no myocardium at risk, then the risk is actually equivalent to somebody who just has coronary artery disease. That's actually a really, really, really important point. All right, back to step four. So metabolic equivalence of task, which is defined as 3.5 mL of oxygen consumed per minute per kilogram. And so here's a sort of a flow sheet of what is METs. Or METs. So basically, if you can rake leaves or you're gardening, you're probably good for most surgery. Your functional capacity is pretty darn appropriate, because what we're looking for is greater than or equal to 4 METs of activity. What I commonly ask them is, can you carry your groceries up a flight of stairs? You got a couple satchels full of, something you picked up at Hy-Vee. Can you go down your your basement stairs and come back up? Can you push a grocery store, a cart that's full around Hy-Vee for a while? To me, that's right around 4 mets or so. And usually makes me feel all warm and fuzzy inside. Playing golf, carrying clubs, I could probably burn about 10 mets of activity playing golf because I suck. Anyways, if they're greater than 4 mets of activity, they can probably go ahead and go to surgery if they're not having an acute cardiac compromise, it's not a low-risk surgery. 4 mets of activity is a pretty good start off. Where we get into the real nebulous area of cardiac evaluation for non-cardiac surgery is in step 5, which is when you start to take into the fact clinical predictors. So we use a scoring rubric here called the Revised Cardiac Risk Index. And this sucker's been validated by several studies as to be the best preoperative scoring for non-cardiac surgery, and hence why it's so important in the ACC-AHA guidelines. And it comes down to this. If you have zero predictors of these predictors here, your high-risk surgery, ischemic heart disease, have a history of heart failure, cerebral vascular disease, diabetes mellitus, and creatinine greater than 2, if you have zero of those, your cardiac risk is about 0.4. If you have 1, it doubles. And if you have 2, it jumps up quite a bit, and obviously 3 is the worst. And it gets pretty dicey even from then on. If you've got all 6 of them, you're pretty much at high risk. And, you know, we've had these patients come through our doors and have done well, but we've had to have honest conversations with both them and their families. So going back to why this is important is that if these patients have these conditions and they're undergoing vascular procedures, well, then we should probably get further cardiac evaluation or up-to-the-minute cardiac evaluation. If they're having an intermediate-risk surgery, gallbladders, appendectomies, any intraperitoneal process is an intermediate-risk procedure. Well, then we have to start considering, should we get an echo? Had a case just the other day where a gentleman is morbidly obese. He's got chronic lower back pain, and he needed to undergo a spine surgery with Dr. Casper, so he doesn't move around very much. He had this sort of glancing history about, yeah, I think I had heart failure about 6 weeks ago when I was admitted to the hospital. They told me I had a bunch of water on my lungs. And, you know, I've been smoking for a long time, and I've got bad COPD, and his creatinine, I think, was 2.1. So I don't know how many nephrons he had left in his kidneys. But we had no echo on this guy, had no idea, and with morbidly obese, most likely obstructive sleep apnea, bad lungs, may have had bad heart failure, so he's probably got some ischemic cardiac disease somewhere in there. We had no echo, and I called up the pre-op evaluator and I had a very polite conversation about why I needed that. And the reason why I need that is, what's going on with his heart? What's his EF? What's his RVSP, which tells me what his pulmonary hypertension status is? Does he have any valvulopathy? Does he have diastolic dysfunction? Does he have wall motion abnormalities? I have to think about all these things as they're occurring in the OR, because the drugs I'm going to give them, the position I put them in, how much fluid we give them will affect any one of those dramatically while they're having surgery. So it would have been helpful to get the phone call, because I would have said, you know what, we got time to get the echo. He doesn't need his back surgery today, and we wouldn't have had to cancel him on that day. Vascular surgery is really, really, really high risk, and this just, you know, really sticks with me because I lost my first patient not too long ago having a vascular procedure who was really high risk. And despite the fact I did probably the best anesthetic I could have done for her, she still died in our recovery room. So at the end of it, if you have a question about it, call me. Call me, call me. I don't care if it's 8 o'clock at night. I have no, I would rather us have a discussion and get the patient perfect before we set ourselves up for a delay or a cancellation. So I'm just going to kind of run through the what I'm thinking about with cardiovascular. And so that kind of sets us up. Do we need more testing? Do we need to have a conversation with the anesthesiologist? But this is sort of what I'm thinking about and why it's important that you describe these conditions. So dyspnea on exertion is an angina equivalent. You know, somebody may not have the chest tightness, but it's pretty much considered an angina equivalent and probably warrants some evaluation. Is it cardiac etiology? So if you tell me in a note, you know, they got shortness of breath, but no paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea and, you know, no orthopnea, they're sleeping on one pillow, that tells me a lot than if you didn't tell me anything at all. Because if you don't tell me, then I have to ask. Did they have angina? So I see in the problem list, chest pain. Like, well, what happened? And if you probably know better than I do exactly what happened. You probably read the ER notes or were given notes forwarded to you about somebody who evaluated it. Oftentimes, I may have to rely on what the patient said. Oh, yeah, they did an EKG and said everything was fine. What I would love to hear is, I got an EKG, I got cardiac enzymes, they were negative, and it was probably just due to my heartburn, and they diagnosed me with a hiatal hernia. That tells me, that's music to my ears rather than not knowing. If they had an angiography, well, what was the result? Because if you don't include it in the pre-op evaluation, I need to have it before we go further with surgery. I need to know what were those dynamics? What were the values that were contained in that report? Same goes for an echo, for all the things that I was just telling you about. I really need to know that in order to devise a proper anesthetic plan. It's not enough just to say they have coronary artery disease. When was it diagnosed? A gentleman that was diagnosed 10 years ago, that was medically managed, put on a statin, was put on metoprolol, has been incredibly compliant for the last 10 years, I'm probably not worried about that guy. What I'm worried about is, can you tell me how compliant they are? Because you have the best idea of how your patient's behaviors, more so than I'm going to glean in 10 minutes. How do you think it's being managed? Are they seeing a cardiologist? And if so, how often? And if they do, what did those notes say? Rather than me having to call up Iowa Heart on the morning of surgery and getting those notes, it would be great if you can include that in your documentation. Also, if they've had a CABG, which vessels? Do I need to worry about the right side of the heart? Do I need to worry about the left side of the heart or both? And what EKG changes might I expect in the OR if that happens? And how long ago did that happen? And, you know, again, what was the echo? Stents. Get this all the time. 2007, stented. Okay, well, how many vessels? Because that tells me the extent of their disease. Were they bare metal or were they drug-eluting? This is very, very important, especially if we're talking in less than a year. Because if they're drug-eluting stents, only life-saving surgery should be allowed within the first 12 months. That's because the risk of thrombosis while being off their Plavix is highly, highly, highly risky. So, and also, what circumstances was it? Was it just sort of, hey, they came in, they were sort of getting fatigued, they had all the risk factors for heart disease, and I decided to send them for an echo or a stress test, and it came back positive, so they did an angio, and then they decided to fix it. Well, that's very different than somebody who had an MI who may have had damaged myocardium. And actually here is a nice little algorithm about what are high-risk stents, so longer than 36 millimeters or overlapping or multiples of them in the same vessels, whether or not they're DES or not, and whether or not they're bare metal. So if it's bare metal stent and it's been longer than 6 weeks, we're probably fine, we're good to go. I may still want to have a conversation with the cardiologist who actually did the procedure or look at their notes, but that's obviously very different than the DES stent. And we abide by this completely. In fact, canceled two cases that they had DES stents that were missed within the first 12 months after undergoing it. Hypertension, huge spectrum. Well, what's going on with their hypertension? How long ago was it diagnosed? How compliant are they? Because this is my surrogate marker for what kind of other end organ damage is going on. It's also very important. So everybody's blood pressure pretty much drops dramatically in the OR. And whether or not I've got somebody that's blood pressure is normally 160 over 70 because they take their ACE every once in a while or their metoprolol every so often, I have to keep them within about 20% of their baseline blood pressures in order to keep them from stroking. There's been patients who have woke up blind, who have had five-hour procedures, who the anesthetist or anesthesiologist didn't maintain that sort of protocol. So I'm going to get to this point that there is actually no evidence that supports us canceling a surgery for somebody whose blood pressure is less than 180 over 110. Wow, I mean, that's a lot. But if they're 180 over 110, well, I'm gonna keep them pretty darn close to that. And, you know, if they're undergoing a shoulder scope and the orthopedic surgeon can't see much because there's a lot of bleeding in there, they're going to ask me for hypotension, and I'm only going to be able to give them what I can because I'm not going to stroke them out. I'm not going to send them into renal failure in order to allow the surgery to, you know, we may have to do something else. And it's also real important to know that a snapshot value is nowhere near as important as what is their baseline. What are their capillary beds used to seeing? That's what I look for. If they come in and they didn't take their ACE because we don't like them to take their ACE on the day of surgery, if they're 190 over 100, but most of the time they're 120 over 70 or whatever, I'm not worried about them, not even close. I will take it because that's what their baseline blood pressure is where I'm going to dictate their care, not what they are on the day when they're pretty anxious about having surgery. AFib, is it new? Is it chronic? Is it paroxysmal? Are we just on rate control? Have we tried cardioversions? Let's say you've had somebody that's had multiple cardioversions. That's actually real important because I may need to be on the lookout. Do I need a cardiovertum in the OR? They were sinus rhythm. We're sitting there doing a gallbladder, and all of a sudden they're in AFib. Well, I'm probably going to take the opportunity to cardiovert them because I know that they have a propensity to slip back into it, and it's been effective for them. But if they're refractory to a cardioversion, well, then I'm not going to even waste my time. I'm going to go for rate control instead. Aortic aneurysms. These are real important because blood pressure dynamics can dictate on whether or not one of these suckers decides to dissect. Where it is can help me to understand if I'm going to get blood pressure changes, especially if I'm in the upper extremity or I start to see variances in the patient's physiology. Also, I will tend to keep the blood pressure in certain dynamic variables in order to try and keep the sucker from dissecting. Pacemakers. I will not take a patient into an anesthetic without understanding their pacemaker AICD fully. So if you can help me with that information, that's really important because we're going to delay the surgery until I get that information because I need to know what's going on with it. When was it placed? Why was it placed? What are the settings? You know, what's its battery life? Which chambers does it affect? Which chambers affect it? And what happens when a magnet is placed? So just about every university setting is now, every pacemaker is interrogated and given a synopsis prior. Anybody that's going for surgery that's not emergent has to have this protocol in place. And so I got this great note. Actually, Dr. Tracy got this great note. This is from the University of Iowa. Every single patient with a pacemaker gets interrogated. And it's a beautiful note. It tells me age of the patient, when it was last interrogated, and the recommendations for how to sort of manage it. So I've got the model number, I've got the serial number. It was implanted for sinus node dysfunction for a heart rate in the 40s. So that tells me they're probably pretty dependent on this. If they were in the 40s when they needed a pacemaker, well, then they're probably pacer dependent. It's in DDDR with a lower rate of 70 and a sensor rate of 130. Very helpful information because I may get outside of that in the OR and may need to come up with strategies in order to fix it. And then per the heart rhythm expert consensus, the patient does not need reprogramming. Okay, so I don't need somebody there the day of the surgery to interrogate it. And if pauses are noted with electromechanical interference or electrocautery, a ring magnet may be applied. And when it does, it's going to go into 85 beats per minute at DOO. Love it. Love it. I'm going to have a ring magnet in the room, and I'm going to know what to do if my bovine from the surgeon is going to start affecting them. I'm just going to put the magnet on there and deal with it. So this is a beautiful note that I would love to have prior to going into surgery because I need to take care of it. And understanding the dynamics of their pacer is just so helpful. Back to the murmurs question. So if you have a murmur, is it benign or is it malignant? Do they have palpitations? Are they dyspneic? Have they had syncope? Is it being followed by echo and is it worsening? And most specifically, it's important to know if is it aortic stenosis or mitral stenosis. These are deadly valvulopathies for general anesthesia, absolutely deadly. And if I know about them, I can plan for them to try and make it less deadly. Carotid stenosis. So if you send them for a Doppler and they had something, well, how much was it occluded? Obviously, 40% is very different than 75%. Neither are operable. But I would like to know, is it getting worse? And it can help me understand if anything changes, not only in the operating room, but after. Okay, that's it for cardiology. So now on to hepatic, which is sort of the easy one because there's not much we can do about it. But other than if I know that their liver is bad, you may not need to get a liver function test before they come to the OR. Just sort of tell me about it, because there are drugs that I use that rely on hepatic clearance that I may not use if their liver function is poorly, has poor compromise. Gastrointestinal, GERD. Oh, we love GERD. GERD is a high risk for aspiration, and so having an idea of where the patient sits on that spectrum is actually very helpful. Because I may intubate somebody who I would otherwise put in a laryngeal mask airway in. Or I may not do a MAC, monitored anesthesia care, on somebody with bad GERD, because I may be worried that I'll tip them into the deep conscious sedation and they may aspirate. So this actually helps us quite a bit. Not only that, but we can prepare to help the patient with their acid reflux symptoms in the perioperative period as well, also from a nausea standpoint. If they have inflammatory bowel syndrome, you know, do they have a lot of diarrhea? If they do, what's going on with their electrolytes? And it's going to be one of the first questions I ask them is, did you have diarrhea in the last day? Well, yeah, Taylor gave me bowel prep. just kidding, Dr. Taylor. Just seeing if he's awake. But the most important part of this is the steroid regimen, because do I need to worry that if a patient's getting hypotensive, do I need to give stress tests or stress steroids in order to help alleviate their adrenal suppression that they've incurred from the anti-inflammatories they've been on? And then should we avoid NSAIDs? Do I need to be lookout on, for gastric ulcers or peptic ulcers? All things we think about. Moving on to renal. Is the dysfunction worsening? There's actually drugs, paralytics that I use, that I'll use one that doesn't rely on any kidney clearance in order for the patient to clear it if their renal function is bad, because I don't want to put more toxins into the nephrons that are already compromised. Have they had acute renal failure? That's also really important to know, because is my fluid choices going to matter? Plasmolite versus normal saline. If I give them too much fluid, am I going to hurt their kidney? Are they able to process it? Am I going to give them pulmonary edema? If they're dialysis dependent, what is their schedule and what's our plan? This is when I need to know what's our plan, because as I said, if we get fluid shifts and blood loss, well, that's obviously going to change the dynamics of their intravascular components, and we may need to have a plan in place for dialysis afterwards for fluid removal and or electrolyte management. Musculoskeletal, if you can tell me what's going on with their joints, their hips, their knees, it may guide me in how we position them. We've put patients in some really funky positions that we need to try to ergonomically prevent paresthesias and nerve damage. Scoliosis, does it cause any pulmonary compromise? And this is also really important. So Downs and chronic rheumatoid arthritis patients are notorious for having allantoaxial subluxation, a weakening between the first and second vertebrae, that if I intubate them and I extend their neck like this, I may cause significant neural compromise. Now, I don't need you to get flexion extension films ahead of that, but if you can tell me that they get parasthetic when they do a neck extension or a neck flexion, that will tell me how serious I need to be about not allowing their head to move while I intubate or even put in an LMA. There's been some of these patients where I've done an awake fiber optic just to avoid causing any neck movement during that procedure. Endocrine, type 1, type 2 diabetes. Is it well, moderate, poor control? Because we get, you know, it's a hyper inflammatory state. You're going to get blood sugar dysfunction in the OR and in the perioperative period. If they're using insulin, what can I do? What is their body used to doing? You know, somebody may be on U500. Somebody may respond to 20 units of regular insulin, very different than 40 units of regular insulin. And me having an idea of that will help me optimize their blood sugars in the perioperative and intraoperative phases. Also, how long have they been diagnosed? So if they haven't had it that long, well, then I'm less worried about their kidneys being compromised, their brain being compromised, their heart, so on and so forth. Hypothyroid, hyperthyroid, knowing how euthyroid they are. So if you can tell me that they're on a stable dose of replacement and we haven't changed anything for a while, well, then I'm less worried about it. Because with hyperthyroid, we're giving them too much. Well, I can have tachycardias, arrhythmias. I can have tremors that may crop up in the perioperative period, which I may think are seizures. I don't know. Hypothyroid, they can become profoundly hypotensive in the OR. They have cardiac depression. They can have pleural effusions that may not have been diagnosed. And they can also be very poorly responsive to hypoxia or hypercarbic states if they're hypothyroid. So it's real important that you help me out knowing what's going on with that. Steroids, back to what we were saying about how much and do I need to give stress dosing. Dyscrasias. So if they're chronically anemic, well, how compensated are they to that? Have they had it for 10 years and we're not doing anything about it? I'm going to maybe have a different trigger than somebody that is poorly compensated about transfusing them during phases of acute blood loss in the OR. If they have thrombocytosis, tell me what your thoughts are on that. Has it been there for a while? Is this something that's cropping up and they've got an inflammatory process that is not related to their surgery that I need to worry about clots? Really helps me out. So DVT, PE, how much of the lung was compromised? What did the CT angio show? What did the chest x-ray show? What were their symptoms? Did you do a formal workup for factor V Leiden protein CNS deficiency? All this helps me to predict problems. Also, if they're on Coumadin, what's our plan? What's our plan for that? Are we going to bridge? So then that way when I ask them on the morning of, did you stop taking your Coumadin? Am I going to be prompted to get an INR? Is surgery going to be prompted to get an INR before we go forward? So that was kind of a trying to go through what we're thinking about and why it's so helpful for you to give us a composite understanding of what's going on with essentially your patient as a preoperative evaluator. I've been putting up on websites, what are the triggers for testing? We tend to over-test in this community, but as a nation as a whole. And so on the website, which we're putting on Mary Greeley, and it's on the physician-only aspect of the McFarland, we are, based on their comorbidities and what surgery they're having, you can decide whether or not you need a Chem-7, a CBC, whether or not you need an EKG. They're all going to be on there to help guide you to not overtest. Like I said, we didn't need an INR for that knee surgery. I was overtesting, as you know, it's costly. Also, we'll have up there and sort of what are the recommendations for getting a 12-lead EKG. This has changed since I've been here. So when I got here 4 years ago and I was telling Dr. Milliman I'm delaying his case to get an EKG, because anybody over 60 has to have an EKG. That's changed since I've been here. So age-based testing is no longer valid. This will be on the website. Basically, there's class 1, class 2, and class 2B situations on ordering an EKG. Truth is, probably don't need it in most of the situations unless they have some of those cardiac issues. Same goes for echocardiography. Truth is, if you're on the fence about ordering an echo, don't order it until you've talked to one of us. Otherwise, why put the patient through it if we're not going to need it? And the only reason we would ever need it is if it's going to affect how we manage the patient. That's it. Any questions? Dr. Taylor.
As intraperitoneal or intrathoracic surgery, how do you rate that with, you know, most of our surgery being done in those cavities laparoscopically now?
Well, your vats and your thoracotomies are probably the most of that high risk category. I would put them in with like neurosurgery. Some of Casper's long back cases are as high risk, but especially the intrathoracic stuff. That's just because we're changing the pulmonary dynamics and the cardiac dynamics so much.
So, Rich, you mentioned herbal supplements. Do you have some that you need to watch out for? Do you have a reference so
we do.
You can check it?
Yeah, it's on the same reference that I just told you about. It's a PDF file that tells you what drugs we would like them to take on the day of surgery and what drugs we really want to avoid. Namely, I could just tell you right now, it's ACE inhibitors and ARBs. Try to avoid diuretics unless they absolutely need it because it changes electrolyte profiles. There's a whole list of herbals. Ginkgo, stay away from ginkgo. Take your saw palmetto, I don't care. But there's a whole listing of what are the green drugs that they can take and what are the red drugs, which don't take. Dr. Bird.
So this issue about avoiding cleared for surgery, which is what we had been told to do in the past.
Yeah.
Some time ago.
Yeah.
Is there some sort of general statement that would be good after we do our thing, say, whenever these medical conditions have been evaluated and optimized for, you know, something that it seems like there should be some sort of statement from us about how we feel rather than just cleared for surgery.
Absolutely. I forget what the statement is, and I can get it to you because I've actually seen it. I think it came from family practice. But basically, they say patient appears reasonable for surgery. No further evaluation necessary. On the day of surgery, the surgeon and anesthesiologist will come up with a plan, based on, if the patient continues to be appropriate for surgery. Something along those lines. I mean, you understand what I mean by really, the patients actually do feel that way. Well, Dr. Bird cleared me. Why are you having a problem with me? And then they're automatically, we're not a solidarity community then that way. And I'm the one picking up the pieces. Because Dr. Bird's a really good doctor. I know what so-and-so was thinking, but this is my concerns, and this is why it matters. So I think if you emphasize during the pre-op evaluation, you're going to talk to your anesthesiologist the day of surgery, and they're going to ask you or evaluate you on whether or not you're appropriate for surgery. The truth is, I actually walk into the room, and I'll say, I read Dr. Bird's note, and I understand that you have this and this and this and this. I find that the patients actually feel pretty relaxed, like we're a community, like we're all looking out for them, and that we're all talking to each other. I think and if we're starting to talk about patient satisfaction models, I think this is an excellent avenue to start investing in that.
Just some quick thoughts on asthma. There's a scattergram that relates severity of symptoms with actual PFTs, and while I certainly wouldn't feel compelled to repeat lung functions that had just been done 6 months earlier and looked okay in a patient who's symptom-free,
right,
for people that haven't had them, I would think there'd be some utility in an asthmatic, for example. They're supposed to all have them, and in fact, guidelines say annually, even for the intermittent ones, which seems excessive to most of us. But right, that said, it seems like lung functions can sometimes clue you into somebody who's relatively stoic and has terrible lungs.
Right.
For whatever reason. And the other quick thought I had, or question I suppose, is, I'm in the habit of routinely telling my patients, what the heck, get some nebulized albuterol if they're prone to jitteriness or palpitations or something. I might use Zopanex and do that for about everybody with any asthma preoperatively. And then I'll jack up the inhaled stuff for people that are already on, if they're on Asthmanex at a puff a day, I'll say two puffs twice a day for the week before surgery. I don't know. There's no science, as far right, as I know, behind that, but it kind of makes sense to me. And people who train me reflexively put everybody, you go in and have your hair cut, and they put you on prednisone for 4 days beforehand. I don't do that. But they were very aggressive with preoperative prednisone for people with any significant measure of asthma. Just some thoughts on all that.
My thoughts on it are sort of this. Equal it to a conversation I have with a cardiologist. So if the cardiologist normally wouldn't stent somebody, like they have cardiac coronary artery disease and they have, affected vessels, but we're not going to stent them because it's not indicated, well, then I actually don't need them to do it either. So the same goes with pulmonary function tests. If you were going to get them anyways, well, then so be it. But I don't necessarily need it for them to go forward for their operative procedure, because it's not really going to change. They kind of are what they are. And by me having a comprehensive functional status conversation with them, or one that's been communicated to me via the note, I can pretty much come up with a plan that is going to get them through that, safely. Or if they do have some issues, well, what's my plan to take care of those? So it's pretty rare that we need PFTs for anything. So if you were going to get them, great. I'm not going to tell you not to, but you know, you don't need to get them before the surgery. Like, let's say they're having surgery 3 weeks from now and you can only get them in for a PFT 4 weeks from now. Well, then go about it.